Hello, my name is Ryan Boyd, and this is your Intro to Graph Databases series. This is episode 4, covering steps to success with a graph database, plus how you move your most connected data from a relational database to a graph database. Now, there are three basic steps to using Neo4j. And the first step is creating your model. Now, you create your model in advance, your labels, your nodes, what's going to be your properties, what are going to be your relationships. You create that in advance. Even though Neo4j is schema optional and you can add and remove these things on the fly later, you want to create an advance for your next step, and that is loading your data. With Neo4j, you load your data using the world's most common file format, a CSV file, and this is super easy to do, and it's very quick, because if you have your data in a relational database, it's usually easy to export this data as a CSV file, and then the command line tools for Neo4j allow you to load data into Neo4j at millions of nodes and relationships every second. So this is a really easy process, even though later, once your application is live, you're going to be loading your data through your application directly. Now, the third step to using Neo4j is querying it. That's why you're using a graph database, after all, is to be able to run queries in an efficient way, in an intuitive way, across your data. So querying your data. How do you query your data with Neo4j? Well, Neo4j comes with a built-in web application that allows you to query your data and see the results. It looks like this. This web application allows you to see your results either in a graph form or in a tabular form, allows you to store your favorite queries and otherwise explore your data. Now, this is a fantastic tool, but it is meant for developers who are working on your application and trying to decide what queries to encode in your application. That is because Neo4j isn't really an analytical database. Neo4j is intended to be your ACID-compliant transactional database to store your most critical business data. So how are you going to query it in most cases? In most cases, your developers are going to write code, and that code is going to query Neo4j servers using Neo4j's APIs. Now, how can you write that code? Well, there are a variety of different language drivers in JavaScript, in Java, in Ruby, in .NET, in Python, in PHP. All of these different language drivers allow you to write code which queries Neo4j. Now, these language drivers, many of them are written by Neo4j, and some of the others are written and contributed to by the Neo4j community. And the community has contributed a wide variety of other drivers as well for up-and-coming languages like Haskell and Go. But what if you need to squeeze every last ounce of performance out of your Neo4j queries, if you want to shave off that last couple milliseconds? Well, you can do that by writing native server-side extensions for Neo4j in Java. With your native server-side extensions, you are hard-coding how to traverse the graph for your queries rather than letting the Cypher query optimizer decide how to traverse the graph for you. And this allows you, oftentimes, because of your intimate knowledge of how your graph works, allows you to get a few extra milliseconds better in your response times. Now, we believe in the concept of polyglot persistence. This means that your application will access the database that best suits the type of data that you need to access. If you have tabular data of columns and rows, it might be best stored in a relational database. But if you have data that's truly relational, that's truly connected, you're going to store that data in your graph database. But there's other types of data stores as well, key value data stores, document data stores, other things which we discussed in previous episodes of this series. And with Neo4j, we believe that you should have those other databases sitting alongside Neo4j as part of your application's architecture. So your application can access any of these types of databases, can also access Neo4j, and then you separately have your data scientist who also accesses these databases and bulk analytic infrastructure in order to determine what queries should be coded into your application to make real-time decisions. Now, moving from a relational database to graph, you have a couple different options. We have some customers that their data is all highly connected. They're performing tons of joins in their SQL queries today, and it's proven that their data is highly connected. So they move all of that data over to Neo4j and into a graph database to take advantage of the fast performance and the intuitive querying of that connected data. Now we have other customers that migrate just a subset of their data. They look at their data that's highly connected and they move that over to Neo4j while keeping the tabular data or key value type data over in other databases. And then their application decides on a query by query basis where the data is located and queries the data in the appropriate spot. Of course, because your application has the ability to decide where to query your data, you can also just migrate or keep all your data in sync between your relational database and your graph database, and then let your application decide on a query by query basis where is the best place to query your data, given that it exists in both places. So now let's talk about how to move from relational to graph. And first of all, why might you want to move from relational to graph? This is a quote from David Meza, and I love this quote because David happens to be the chief knowledge architect at NASA, which we like to think is full of tons of smart people. And he says, "I love Neo4j because I can explore relationships faster than you can say SQL join." Before we get into this, I just want to say that you're going to see some handwritten drawings, some tables, some handwritten text. And I hired this young gentleman to write that text. So if you can't read it, if it looks like a young gentleman wrote that text, well, he did. So don't blame me, please. Now, a day in the life of a relational database developer. A relational database developer's ideal table looks something like this. We have people and the country that they're from, their hair color, the university that they attended, and all of this data is in a table that's really easy to read. It'd be easy to onboard new people onto the team because they would easily understand what's going on here. But it's hard to maintain consistency when you have your data in a form like this. You can see that we use UK multiple times, you can see that we reference Princeton multiple times, and what happens if the name of one of these countries, or more likely one of the universities, changes? Well, we want to maintain consistency. So we create another table. We create another table with the names of each of the countries. And this allows us to populate some additional information about those countries, such as the leader and all, while maintaining consistency. But you can see that we're using these auto-generated numerical primary keys, which then we're going to reference as foreign keys in our other table. And this table becomes a little bit harder to read. And then when you do this with multiple tables, you do this with university as well, the table becomes very difficult to read. Now, this is just trying to read one table as a developer if you're looking at the raw table in your database. Of course, if you're doing this for real, you're going to also have views and you're going to have SQL queries you can execute, but also you can read and understand your data. And then you're going to have to produce an ER diagram that shows how everything interrelates. And you're going to use this ER diagram to onboard new members of your team. And then you're going to write SQL queries. And those SQL queries are going to have your join statements. Now, this isn't too bad when we just have these three tables. But we have a lot of customers and a lot of people in the community that I've spoken to that have 20, 30, 40 different tables that they're joining together. And their ER diagram includes just as many tables that it's very difficult to communicate how the database works when you onboard someone new, either as a DBA or as an application developer. And most importantly, because these queries are so complex and hard to write, you have your relational database developer, and she is thinking about these joins all day long, all night long. They're even keeping her up at night and making it less performant for her to do her job. Now, not only is her job a little less performant, but when you have this many joins, your database is also less performant because your database relies upon searching all of the data. Now, you can make this a little bit better by creating indexes, which you certainly should, and this prevents your full table scans, but you create an index on every single primary key. And that means every time you're doing this join operation, you are looking at a different index. Now imagine if you didn't just have to look through this one drawer in this card catalog, but you had to look through 20, 30, or 40 different drawers in this card catalog to perform a query, that would be painful. It's painful for the database as well, and that results in reduced performance as your data size increases. So to deal with a reduced performance and enable faster querying of your database, oftentimes what happens next is you denormalize your data. You take your data back out of the normalized form and create a denormalized form of your data that allows you to query your data more quickly. But again, this has the problems of inconsistencies. It also has a problem of write time performance. You have to update every single row if you updated the name of that country or the name of that university. So this becomes difficult to maintain. So with SQL, developers often find it hard to create their queries and model their relationships. The performance degrades as the data size increases because of all of those joins and all of those index lookups that we talked about. And the queries get really long and complex due to the same. Maintenance becomes very painful because you don't know how all your data is working, and if you have to add new tables to your join statements that are 20 or 30 or 40 joins long, this is very challenging. But what if we converted our data into something like this? What if we converted our data into a graph? A graph that can be easily read using the English language. So in this case here, you can see that a person went to a university, that university is located in a state, that university is led by a president or a leader, all very easy to read. And the queries are actually very easy to read in Cypher as well. If you remember, Cypher is our declarative query language that's similar to SQL, but optimized for graphs, and it's optimized for readability. You can see here that we're matching a person. Now that P is just an alias, so we're saying matching a person, call it P, who went to a university, call it U. And that person lives in a country, and that university is led by a leader, and that university is located in a state where the state's abbreviation is Connecticut. And then return the various columns similar to how you would return your data in a relational database. This is pretty awesome and much easier to read and understand than a bunch of join statements. Now let's talk about how you convert your data from a relational model into a graph model. And this is pretty simple, and I'm going to show you the common steps that you use to convert your data. Well, first of all, we have our ER diagram. And if you're like me and many other database developers out there that work with relational databases, just seeing this ER diagram kind of makes you sad. Because you have to look throughout it and see where all the primary keys and foreign keys are and understand that before building your application. Now, this ER diagram has things like customers and orders and what products are in those orders and salespeople and what territories they cover. Now, you may recognize this data set as the Northwind data set. Northwind is the canonical relational database example. It was originally created by Microsoft and distributed as demo data with SQL Server. But we're going to show you how to convert Northwind to a graph database and hopefully make some of your people who were sad when looking at an ER diagram happy when looking at the graph model. And hopefully also show you that Northwind is much better as a graph than it is in a relational database. So we start off with our ER diagram, and we first locate our foreign keys, and we eliminate the foreign keys, and we replace those with relationships. Next, we locate our join tables, and you can see here that we have two join tables. One join table joins our orders with the items that are in the order, and the other join table joins our employees with the territories that they represent. Now, the one that represents the relationship between our employees and territories is a really simple join table. And this simple join table just becomes a relationship. But the other join table we have here that's showing the items that are in an order and what sort of quantity was placed with that order and what the price was and things like that, that's a little more complex. We convert that attributed join table to a relationship, but that relationship has a set of properties as well. Because as you remember with Neo4j, not only can your nodes have properties, but your relationships can have properties. Today we're going to talk about a subset of your data here. And we're converting that subset of data into a graph. And you can see this graph is already much easier to read than the ER diagram that we were looking at before. It's easy to understand what the data is and how the data works, and thus easy to onboard new members of your team. So I think I've shown you that graphs make it much easier to model and query your relationships. Your performance overall increases versus a relational database, because as the size of your data increases with a graph database, in particular with Neo4j, it does not reduce the query times of querying the subsets of your graph. And this is because Neo4j uses what's called index-free adjacency. What it means is, as you're traversing the graph, as you're moving from one node to another node over a relationship, it's super, super quick. It's essentially just doing pointer arithmetic, either on memory or on disk, instead of doing index lookups. And this gives us that important performance advantages, in addition to being more intuitive to model your data and query your data. And your queries are much smaller and much more understandable. And then adding additional properties and relationships on the fly makes it much more agile. There's no more schema migrations, which all of you relational database developers and DBAs are probably sick of those keeping you up at night as well. So next up, we're going to show you how to query your graph in Neo4j using the Cypher declarative query language. Thank you very much, and hope you have a fantastic day.